Come. Can I begin or Don Juan, tell me. Fini. Sorry for that. All right. Welcome, everybody. Thanks for coming on a Friday evening here instead of the Potato Festival. Tomorrow. All right. My name is Bradley, and welcome to the Artist WERC Talk, the second one. I want to bring the guys on stage here to talk a little bit more. My name is Bradley. I will be moderating today, and it will not be a one-way presentation. I really want to have your engagement. We're going to go dive deeper in later, but I really, if you have questions in between, raise your hands and we ask questions, because it's a nice dialogue to have certain people ask about certain questions. Is that clear for you? All right. Anything, as it's a big crowd, if you need a drink, do it quietly in between, please. Don't you know? It's fine to get a drink, but keep it a little bit low-key. All right. Guys, so big applause. Okay? I'm going to ask first some questions to the guys. So, to Olaf, first one. Yeah, Olaf. What is the artist series talks and why did you want to organize this?
Yeah, we'll do it this way. So what is the artist talk and why
you want to organize
it? So with WERC we have been, I think, steadily building for the last 10 years. And during those, during all of our experimentation and work, we've met so many artists all over the world and nice people to talk to, technicians, programmers, just really interesting people. And us coming back to Groningen, where we have our home base for these 10 years, we wanted to give something back to the city, and we wanted to also have this more communal-based place where artists can share thoughts and have nice conversations. And then we want to bring in artists that we look up to. We want to bring in people that we see in the field of digital media, of media, that are doing interesting things, have a nice track record. And we want to bring them to Groningen to have them have a conversation with you guys, with us, and yeah, just share those knowledge. We don't want to be a typical talk, but we just want to be like artists sharing interesting things.
As hosting this beautiful place, so what makes WERC? For the people who doesn't know, can you explain to me what and why? Why is WERC and why?
So WERC is currently is the three of us, Joachim, Jelle, and me, Olaf. And we work with a lot of interns. And like I said, we've been working for the last 10 years. But I think what WERC is that we chase everything that we find interesting in the field of digital media. It can be, and then it can be an output that is logical. So it can be a theater performance, it can be a light artwork, it can be an interactive installation, it can be just lights, it can be video, and everything in between, the whole bandwidth. And it comes from experimentation and our fascination for the whole digital realm, all the new digital media that we have in our pockets, in our worlds, in our society.
And then I have a question for Joachim. So we have here tonight people coming beside WERC for Blast Theory. So why you invited Matt Adams from Blast Theory as a guest?
Yes, so why Matt Adams from Blast Theory? He is the... Well, first, I think when people were here last time, they maybe heard me say, like, next time it's going to be Matt Adams from Blast Theory. He's this super cool, fun artist. And that's the first thing that I see from him. Like, he's fun. The things they make, they're almost funny. Exactly. No, but that's the but as soon as you dive in a little bit deeper, there's like it's layered. It's about societal questions. It's not just about hey, here's the piece, here's the work, here's the thing, here's the digital interactive sort of thing. But there's always this deep layered thing behind it. But like covered in this really amazing, playful little like surrounding.
How do you describe that collective? I mean, it's not only Matt, but how do you describe them?
I'm not quite sure if that's a job up for me.
For their work, how do you see it as a fellow artist? Maybe how do you?
The one thing that I noticed about it, it's daring. It's not neat. It's not afraid to ask like these really big things and just follow them through, right? These works that go insane, that go like, all right, we're just gonna do this and we're gonna do it full. And that's something that's super inspirational. All right, and like all right, I want to be more like that, and I want to know more from it.
So you're gonna ask also some questions to Matt in between.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah, you have some other things to add to the work.
I think in a way, like also like why did we ask Blast Theory? Obviously because they make great artworks, that they have an amazing track record. But it wasn't too long ago when an old intern of us, Isabella, took a book on digital sonography, and Blast Theory was mentioned in this book. And I went to their website, an amazing website, and I wasn't only impressed by their artworks. I thought immediately, like, wow, they have such a great organization as well. They must work with such a cool team of people. Like, Anne is here, their business director, and they have this awesome studio in Brighton. They rent out studio spaces to other artists. They have an artist in residency program, and over the years, like 80 or 90 artists from all over the world has visited their studios to create artworks. They've been working with the University of Nottingham mm-hmm. for over 20 years with the Mixed Reality Lab. They offer paid internships. They have European funding for research projects. And I'm just like, wow. Like, next to making great artworks, they manage as an organization, as a group of people, as a team, to adapt, be flexible, and to build this whole organization. And I was
just well, let's squeeze out then Matt, so because everybody is very so. I want to thank you all as hosts. So we come up later. So give a big applause to the boys and a big applause to Matt. Thanks. So on stage is Matt Adams from the Blast Theory. We're going to dive, as he has many projects, he's going to explain a little bit, a short trailer about the work, but we're going to take specific one project. We're going to dive, so we're going to ask questions, more dive into deep behind the scenes, and have a nice dialogue and conversation and a big fight and kick ass. All right? Enjoy.
Thank you. Thanks so much. And thank you for that lovely introduction. That's extremely kind of you. Let's see whether I can live up to that billing. So, first of all, I'd just like to show a short video clip of some of the works that we've made.
Hi. Hello.
Need some sound. Thank you.
Okay, I'm just going to go back. So we start that.
Hi. Hello.
Can you explain a little bit what Blast Theory is in general to the people who never saw you?
Of course, yes. And I wanted to reiterate that all the work we make is interactive, and I'll be talking about that. And so I also welcome very much any question that you have as we go. Please just raise your hand at any moment, and I will be very happy to stop and have a conversation. It's a nicer way to talk about the work that we make. So. We are a group of three artists. I collaborate with Juro Farr and Nick Tandabanich, and we've been making work together since the early 1990s. coast of England. And as Jelle mentioned, we've collaborated a lot with a whole range of different partners, but particularly with the University of Nottingham and the Mixed Reality Lab. It's been a key part of how we've made our work. From me, my background is in theatre, but we're an interdisciplinary team. And the thing that really I wanted to kind of draw as a thread in the talk tonight is about why we make work that is interactive. And for me, that is a story about how whether art can change the world and how it might do so. And I wanted just to kind of take some small moments from my personal kind of history that act as kind of reference points when I think about that. Question. Perhaps the first moment that I really engaged with the idea of art and social and political change is in the immediate aftermath of the Russian Revolution and the explosion of artistic activity that happened that was focused around social change. And in particular, this play, Mystery Booth by Mayakovsky, is a kind of a moment where theatre makers tried to remake the theatrical language in order to remake society. So people are thinking about the fundamental languages of how art is made and where it is made in order to think about how society might be changed. And at the same time, there's a kind of very clear systematic part of that agenda where the Soviets realized that cinema was a very powerful propaganda tool early on, and they built trains like this one that could tour the Russia and the Soviet Union and show films and show propaganda materials. So you have both a kind of an artistic drive coming towards it and a kind of governmental and systematic drive about thinking about how messaging and art might change society. And then in the 20s and the 30s, Brecht, of course, is the most legendary theater maker in terms of social and political choice voices in that period. But for me, Erwin Piscator is equally important. And one of the reasons that I love Piscator's work is that he was also interested in the formal properties of theatre. So it was a real eye-opening moment for me to discover that Piscator designed entire theatrical spaces to enable moving cinema screens to be present in the auditorium, for example. So it's a multimedia way of thinking and a way of thinking about the whole structure of how theatre happens. And the last piece of work that I wanted just to mention is really something as representative of the moment in the 60s and 70s of radical theatre, particularly in the UK and the US. And I picked this play. This is a play called Fanchon, written by David Hare, it's a play about the collectivization of farms in China, in communist China. But the work was also made in a collective way and in a devised way by a group who'd come together to try and put their political principles into action in terms of how they made work.
And in that sense, the current time now as a radical collective in theater making, do you see the current movement going that direction, or are you missing that? From your personal spinsel, yeah.
Yeah, I think we're at a moment where what a political agenda looks like is very different. So I think the idea that we had that there was an ideological opposition to capitalism, mm-hmm. and that could be expressed through art and culture as a way of imagining new ways of organizing society, I think we've kind of lost faith in that idea, mm-hmm. and so we've, in my perspective, we've fallen into single issue politics or identity based politics, and that those are the frames through which people are making work. Some of that work is amazing, but for me it is we're still searching for the new framework, and we're also in a particularly pessimistic moment politically. That's maybe another.
How many artists are here who are making theatre?
Yeah.
Or as somebody here are there artists here who do performances? Or I'm very curious about the balance. Here in front, more and more, yeah. Right? We're going to dive in deeper. So we're going to talk later about specific project, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Why you choose that project to show? Before we dive into deeper, very curious from your point of view as you showed your previous work.
I think it's a good illustration of how we've made a journey as artists from trying to make political work in a very direct way to thinking about politics as a more multifaceted question. So my personal journey has been more towards the way in which art can open up new possibilities and new ways of thinking, and that in itself can have validity. And I think my 25-year-old self would have been very dismissive of that as non-ideological. Mm-hmm. Now I believe that that is a sincere and noble goal, and that that in itself can be socially and politically important.
All right, very clear. But still now, anybody questions for him in terms of his introduction as we move on further? Don't be shy. No, everything fine? It's up to you for the stage now.
So, almost all the work that we make is interactive, and I always love to talk about this this quote. This is essentially a quote from Brian Eno, the musician, where he says, interactive work is unfinished. And what he means by that is that an interactive work has space for the public to complete it. You're leaving something open. You're not just getting someone to press a button to do something, you're leaving space. And for me, that's a key part of the reason why I'm making interactive work. I'm not really going to talk so much about politics anymore, but where that journey comes from is the sense that when you make interactive work, you create space for people to have agency and control within the work, and that that in itself is something rich aesthetically and politically. So I'm just going to talk about a small number of the works that we've made in that context. This is Gunman Kill 3. It's the first show we ever made. This photo shows a moment in that piece of work where we invited someone in the audience who had never fired a gun before, who wanted to fire a gun for the first time, to come out of the audience and take a paintball gun and fire a gun at these the two performers that you can see in the background here. So you can see that right from the very beginning, we're trying to create a hybrid language, something where interaction also involves ethical questions and involves high stakes situations, and where we're thinking about trying to make something that is as much an event as it is a piece of theater. We wanted to have a moment where everyone in the room went, oh shit, is this, am I about to watch an act of violence? And how do I feel about this? Is this performance, or is this now crossing over into something that is real, is outside of the frame of performance?
Question from Joachim.
Yeah, so it has less to do with the work, but more about this, because this is the first work you made. How did you form? Was this the idea that you wanted to work with the three people mm-hmm. to form this piece, or had one person had the idea?
So we found an article in the Guardian called Gunmen Kill 3 at Mobile Shop, and it described a murder in Northern Ireland in quite a lot of detail, step by step, what happened where two people were killed, three people were killed. And from that, Juro Farr and I read it and said, you could make a piece of performance from that. We invited everyone we knew who we thought could be in any way interested to come to our house on a Wednesday evening to talk about the show that we might make about this newspaper article. Eight people turned up, and four of those people, four or five of us stayed the course, and about 4 months later, we hired a church hall and we put on the show.
All right, clear.
Jumping forwards. In 1998, we ran a lottery in England where you paid £10 to enter the lottery, and the first and second prize was to be kidnapped by us. And this is Russell. Russell knew he was going to be kidnapped on this day, so that T-shirt he's wearing is his own choice. That is nothing to do with us. It's a complex piece of work that is in some ways inspired by a famous trial that happened in the UK in the early 1990s, where four gay men who practiced sadomasochism were sent to prison because their defense that everything that they did was in private and was consenting among four adults was rejected by the judge, and they were convicted of grievous bodily harm and sent to prison. So in some ways, this is a work about consent and the limits of consent. But it's also the first piece of work that we make that really is out in the public domain. We made a short cinemas that were seen by 800,000 people. We did a sponsorship deal with a clothing company to put the entrance forms in 200 clothes shops around the UK. We spent most of our budget on a PR campaign with a press agency because we knew that the press was going to be a key part of it. So the work is a kind of fragmented thing where it's happening in loads of different spaces at different times. It's also the first time we make work online because the 2 days of the kidnap was streamed onto the web.
Strategically wise, did you really deliberately make a PR campaign as a collective to push it out in the open those days?
Yeah, we did. And we did an exclusive deal with the Sunday Times to do a 3-page article about the piece of work. And in order to achieve that, we kidnapped a Sunday Times journalist to do a test run for him to write about it.
And your previous work, you did a completely radical change in approach on to make it more public. Is that you get less attention in your previous work, or because you thought you're as a collective thing from, hey, it's so good, we want to bring it more wider?
No, it's not really about that. We're not that driven by press and PR and public attention. But what we wanted, what we felt this work was about, was an invitation to everyone to participate in this piece of work, and we wanted that then to be out in the public domain. We also wanted there to be an instability in the public rhetoric around the work as to whether this was a business, an artwork, a stunt, a joke, a kind of sexual underground, like a performance. We wanted that status to be uncertain, and we felt that the only way to do that would be for us to take control of the narrative and the press.
Oh, clear. Thanks.
By the late 1990s and early 2000s, we started to make work with the Mixed Reality Lab, and this is the second game project that we made, and I have a 1-minute video which will explain this hopefully better than I can, and will give you a little flavor of how this piece of work unfolded.
Do you want me to announce it? This is runner 6. Okay. Runner 6 is this.
Can You See Me Now is an online game. Players log in and are dropped at a random location in a virtual city. Players move their avatar through the streets to avoid being caught by the runners, who are represented in the virtual world in red. The runners are performers on the streets of the city who are equipped with GPS receivers and PDAs with GPRS cards. The runner's speech is streamed live to the website, and online players can respond using a chat window.
Trying to get Emily. Hello, Emily.
So,
sorry. Yep. Anybody questions about this last one? Well, cool. All right. We have one.
What's that? That wasn't, but it was first done in the UK in 2001 in Sheffield, and but we didn't have enough money to film it until 4 years later.
The act of reality.
Yeah.
Thanks.
And then what the last project that I would mention is this piece of work, Ulrika and Eamon Compliant. It's a piece of work we made for the Venice Biennale in 2009. And it's a work where you walk through the city, having chosen whether to be Ulrika, who is in fact Ulrika Meinhof, one of the founder members of the Red Army faction, a West German terrorist group from the late 1960s to the early 1970s, or Eamon, who was a senior member of the Irish Republican Army in Northern Ireland in the late 1970s and 1980s. And both of these two people, whichever one you choose, they're people who were intellectuals, who were outside of the standard political discourse, who ultimately decided to endorse political violence. And so over the course of the work, you follow their journey towards political violence, and ultimately the work treats you as if you are Ulrika or Eamon, and the culmination of the work is that as a participant, as a member of the public, you go into a room that is actually a mirror copy of this one, and you sit down with someone inside that room, and they say, "What would you fight for?" And there is then an unrehearsed discussion with that person about the ethics of political violence or pacifism and what that might mean. And in all of our work, we're always trying to think about what is the voice that you have as a member of the public when you come to interact in our work. You can see in Can You See Me Now, in some ways it's a very simple and playful game. Most of the time you're using your four arrow keys on your keyboard to move your avatar around, and there's a little chat window. It's mostly light and playful and fun. In Ulrika and Eamon Compliant, by this point we're trying to go, okay, what is the limit? How far could we go to give you an experience that is interactive but also personally challenging, where your voice is everything? And so for those few minutes inside that interrogation room, as you have this discussion with a performer, you are in a position where you're testing yourself and your own ideas about whether you would commit political violence or not. And for me, that gives you a different position, because so rarely in life are we ever actually challenged about our ideas. Mostly we're too polite to really do that, or we get stuck in some, you know, narrow argument with someone at a party or something. You know, it's like we don't often have a context where we can test ideas, and in Ulrika and Eamon Compliant, we're really trying to think about that.
Do you want to challenge yourself, or do you want to challenge the audience on the reaction from Ulrich with this subject, especially with the Rota Me Fraction and Ulrich?
I'm only making that work because I am wrestling with that question myself. Yeah.
But you lose a lot of public interaction. You lose a lot of, if you see the old work, if you have time after this, check the website with all the different work. It's quite interactive how you use audience interacting with your work or capturing.
Yeah. Yep. And also that the work must always involve me putting something personally on the line about my own ideas or my own beliefs. And sometimes that is just about uncertainty, but it's that always that I am invested within the piece of work. You know, and I think that transmits through the work, and that people can feel that there is something at stake for within that work, that the work is not a complete expression of a preformed idea, that is in some way an exploration or an investigation of some degree of uncertainty.
What is your role in Blast Theory as a collective?
We don't have set roles.
Okay.
We work very slowly with enormous amounts of discussion, sometimes 6 or 8 hours of discussion, and then I will look back over the day and I'll have 100 words of notes from those 6 or 8 hours. And sometimes we have deep disagreements, and the only way that we resolve those disagreements is through returning to that argument again the next week and returning to it next week, and very slowly you realize that it's turning slightly in some way, and over time we will nearly always find some kind of route out of that where you say, okay, it doesn't have to be A or B. We can now find a synthesis of those positions, or in some way what we thought was a fundamental disagreement doesn't look like a disagreement.
So time and the moment you say this is the right figures, this is the right direction, we proceed, correct?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm curious about the work we're going to see later. Deepa. Yeah. Question.
Given direction,
mm-hmm.
Which I find interesting, then mm-hmm. what would be the change that you're aiming for?
Yeah, so thank you. It's could you all hear that?
Could you hear that?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So it's because as we made work during the 1990s, I developed to that point of realizing that actually the most sophisticated political position is one that engenders deeper thought and more sophisticated consideration. And essentially, you know, I came to see artistic work and activist work as really diametrically opposed, because as an activist you have to simplify your ideas down to a position where you can actually create change. And that is the focal point, the sharp point of activism, is to say, yeah, we are going to get this law changed, we're going to boycott this product, we're going to do X or Y. And as an artist, I see my role as going in the opposite direction, which is to maximize complexity and not be afraid of confusion, and to do that in a social and political framework. So not to use that as an excuse to turn away from political questions, but to suggest that all political questions are situated in that vector, and that that in itself is a rich and important thing to do. Now that may be just me chickening out, you know, like that may be just a kind of an avoidance of me having to take political responsibility and existing in a world of art where you're allowed to get away with this kind of stuff. But that's the position that I suppose I came to.
Any more questions later? All right, let's move on.
I'm going to do a segue as well from your question, because I wanted to talk about the trolley dilemma. I don't know, does anyone know about the trolley dilemma? Are there a few people? Would you raise your hands? Okay, so maybe about half the people. So this is the trolley dilemma, or a version of it. A trolley or a train is running out of control down a track, and in its path are five people who will get killed by that train. But you are watching, and you can flip a switch to switch the train onto another track and avoid those five people. But there is someone on that track, and in flipping that switch, you will be killing them. Would you kill them? And I discovered this while we were working on Eureka and Aim and Compliant in 2009. It comes from this woman, the rather amazingly looking Philippa Foot. She's an English philosopher of ethical problems. Particularly, she was looking at the moral positions around abortion in the late 1960s, and she essentially came up with this initial idea. And the reason I think it's relevant to the question that you were mentioning is, if you think about this, this is a binary choice. It's like you either do flick the switch or you do not flick the switch. So in some ways, it's a really simple interactive question. On the other hand, it contains multitudes of ethical challenges and philosophical questions about what do you think your responsibility is? Is it, would you, you know, are we justified to take violent action under certain conditions? And I suppose in a way that is where I think that is where I've tried to sort of land some of those questions about political change, is to try and find those a binary question that in its consideration brings you to think about more sophisticated things.
Do you like to play on the border from responsibility from an artist's point of view?
I'm not afraid to upset people or to cause people discomfort, but I think the only way you can do that is from a deeply ethical position of responsibility. And so in fact, the welfare and the safety of people who participate in the projects that we do is of enormous importance to us, and we spend enormous amounts of time and effort to ensure that people are safe and are well looked after and are cared for. Of course, that's changed over time, as our knowledge and thinking about the welfare of others has changed over time. And there are things that I did in my 20s that I don't think I would do now.
Okay. Oh, wait, there's a question at the back.
How do you take care of people? Ah. Is that the question? How do you take care of people? Yeah.
Right, good question.
I think it's different for different pieces of work. I mean, sometimes it is physical safety. So for example, in Kidnap, we kidnapped Russell and Deborah. They were the two people who won, and we kept them for 48 hours locked in a room. Some of that was about physical care, but the other way we did that is to have a psychologist present for the whole 48 hours, and she was there to observe us, not to observe as much as to observe Russell and Deborah, because of course the danger is that you get carried away with the power, right? That you have people under your control and you start to lose focus and lose clear thinking. So we specifically asked her to test us and to check us and to make sure that we are thinking carefully about the mental welfare of the two people that we kidnapped.
Is that based on experience? Did you ever fuck it up?
We've had people have panic attacks during our work. We've had the police called. We've been arrested. I personally have been kidnapped while playing Can You See Me Now. Yeah. Four men who played the game drove and grabbed me and took me. So, you know, it's like we're playing on the line between fiction and reality, and inevitably that is an edgy place to occupy sometimes, and that can be for good and for ill, right?
Is it your answer? Is okay. Thanks.
Oh,
yeah. All yep. Tell me.
God damn you. No, I mean, I think, I mean, in Kidnap, I you know, it like that, those kinds of projects, I think I would be much more careful about the mental welfare of the two people, right? Russell and Deborah, we invited them to come to the after show party, right? So we kidnapped them for 2 days, then we released them, and then we were like, we're having a party tomorrow night, just come to that if you want. And so then Russell, they both then came, and Russell then stayed on our floor, and he slept in our house for 24 hours. So it's like this, you know, and at that time we thought that was, you know, aftercare, right? And it's like, I think you could probably do something a little bit more rounded than that now. And yeah, you know, we did a show with a pit bull on a lead in a show about rioting and stuff. And it's like we're mingling the crowd with a pit bull and stuff. And it's like, you know, there are things like that where I think it was probably safe, but I don't think we would do that too.
Is that the reason we're going to only show the next project, not humans?
Yeah, yes. It's a good segue. I thought Olaf Joachim and Jelle asked me to sort of give some of the sort of back sort of under the bonnet a little bit of the making of a work and to think about sort of how a work is made, and I just thought that Cat Royale might be a good example. So I'm going to dive in and talk about it as before. Please do just stick your hand up and interrupt if you have a question. So one of the ways in which we're able to make our work is through research relationships, and in this instance, this is a project that only exists because the UK government decided that there was a risk around trust and AI, and that they needed to do research into how to build trust around AI, and they created a program of research called Trustworthy Autonomous Systems. And we were invited to be the cultural ambassadors of that. And as part of that, it was, please will you make an artwork that deals with trust and autonomous systems. So we started to look into AI, something that I knew nothing about really, and realized that machine learning is incredibly opaque, and that even when you talk to developers, an inherent part of AI is that it's hidden, and it's not always clear how the system is arriving at the output that it's arriving at. And it is, of course, notorious for taking existing biases and reproducing them at scale. And it's extremely hard to grasp. If you ask AI experts for a definition of AI, they all tell you something slightly different. There is no unified agreement.
Can you explain to the audience what you say about what AI, your definition is?
So, I think of it as computer code that is able to, when trained on a set of data, is then able to learn progressively based on that data in a semi-autonomous way. So one of the things that I have learned that is, I think, really relevant is that there is no unattended AI anywhere on Earth, right? All of this stuff is being monitored and attended and bug fixed and tweaked, and humans are sitting observing the system and adjusting it. So, you know, they are semi-autonomous.
Is that the reason the word trust in the title before, you know, from the assignment, is then part of the AI learning you from your point of view in this project? In terms of cleanness, no humans, and that animals, we will see later, is being trained?
It's a really complicated question, but I suppose what I think is that that we learn to trust technology incredibly quickly. Once it's done two or three times, it's done what we thought we were expecting it to do, we trust it. And so we've grown up, and that's the reason we've grown that way, is because we've lived in a period of enormous technological change. GPS is a great example. None of us are thinking about the fact that our phone is connected to satellites anymore, but it is, and it does that just seamlessly, and we're now so used to it, we don't even think about it. So trust is a real risk, because we've grown used to the idea that technology can bring us certain solutions.
Thanks. No questions.
I'm gonna jump ahead, because I'm kind of conscious of time a little bit. So, this is the idea. This is the piece of work we came up with in response to that brief, which is we're going to create a utopia for cats. We're going to give them everything that they could wish for. Viewing platforms, raised platforms, little runways, little cubby holes, walls that they could climb, floors that were curved that were perfect for curling up in, places where they could be together, places where they could be apart. And into that space, into that utopia, we're going to put a robot arm controlled by an artificial intelligence. And the AI won't do anything to do with the welfare of the cats. That will all be taken care of by humans. But the AI will try and play with the cats. And a computer vision system will observe the entire setup. And we set the AI the goal of maximizing the happiness of the cats. So the cats start every morning, they start with a score of 50%, and based on whether they engage with the games, if they engage with the game, we assume that they're slightly happier, and it increments slightly, and if they ignore the game, we assume that they're not that happy, and that we decrement their happiness score very slightly. And this is a screenshot from Cat Royale. Pumpkin, Ghostbuster, and Clover are our three cats. Ghostbuster is the father to Pumpkin and Clover. And this is a happiness score. So in some ways, we're looking to satirize the idea that computers can make us happier. But it is worth pointing out that both Elon Musk and Mark Zuckerberg are both on record as suggesting that their goal with their companies is to increase the sum total of human happiness. So it's not quite as satirical as it might ideally be. I thought it might be interesting just to talk a little bit about how we went through this process of designing a utopia. How do you do such a thing? One of the ways is to work with experts in feline behavior, and I'll talk a bit more about that later on. But this is the very first visualization that we came up with. Nick produced this, and we were talking about sort of a sense of cats as regal creatures, and obviously Cat Royale is the title, so we're thinking about this idea of creating a vitrine for the gallery and a place that is entirely luxurious in every way, that sort of quilted velvet or something like that. This lasted about 2 seconds once I began to talk to feline experts, because they said, oh, cats will hate this in every single way. This is a terrible idea. Cats do not want to be on display. They do not want to be exposed in that way, and they need to have private space where they can retreat. And so we went through a whole phase of research. We started to look at the work of Danish designer Werner Panton, legendary for his work in the sort of 1960s and 1970s. And this was a particular environment that really caught my eye, where it's like, oh, this is such a seductive space, and it's a space that sort of has no real function. It's a space for sort of hanging out or lounging or, you know, having a good time. Did you have a hand up?
Yeah. Question.
I mean, no specific reason. Just looking. We started to look for the sort of 60s and 70s era of design that was all about sort of hanging out in lounge suits and sort of sunken sofas, and there was something about this sense that it was kind of utopian, science fiction.
Drugs.
Yeah, drugs, sex, you know, it's like a kind of louche kind of lifestyle that was sold in the 60s and 70s. Waterbeds, you know, all of that kind of moment. So then we worked with a studio of designers in Brighton called We Make Stuff Happen, And the this is one of the first designs that they came back to us with, based on the brief that we gave them. And you know, this has all of the spaces that I talked about, and you can see the robot arm there, the white robot arm in the middle. And then this is in the studio, starting to build that that environment.
What time between the concept and when we saw this? What time? What is the period of time?
It's probably only 4 months between seeing
that's quick
and this being the finished object.
What's the pressure? What's the time limit? Oh, okay.
People just think a little bit.
All right. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it was a project that was. I will happily talk about this if anyone wants to be inflicted with it, either during the session or afterwards, about the ethical challenges of realizing a project that involves research where cats are together with a robot. And that's caused us enormous production difficulties, and the work was very nearly cancelled. And so then by the time it was not cancelled and was going ahead, we had...
Okay. All right. Oh, question from Olaf.
Yes. So we looked at about 30 different robot arms, and we spent time at the Cobot Makerspace at the University of Nottingham, which is their robotics lab for investigating how robots and humans work together. And this robot is specifically designed for working with humans. It's very weak. It only lifts 500 grams. The jaws are very sensitive to any disruption, as is the arm itself. So we felt that there was less chance of it crushing a cat. And you know, it was essentially about trying to find the safest possible robot for interacting with small mammals.
And you call it Cobot, not robot then?
That's what they call it.
Okay.
I don't call it that.
Yeah. All right. Crushing a cat, all right. Yes.
Yes. No, from the three universities who run the Trustworthy Autonomous Systems Hub, which is the center of the research. So they like to it's partly public engagement with science. It's partly about framing new questions, and it's partly about the way in which we as artists can challenge them about how they're thinking about what they're doing. So all of them were, to say the least, shocked by the idea that we wanted to put cats into this research, right?
That Why not
that
dogs?
Not being part of the way in which they thought about it, and it's an act of tremendous trust on their part to go, okay, we will go with this. Generally, we've ended up in a situation where they go, actually, we've learned things that we did not think about before, and the questions came out of this that are really rich, and now we have another whole strand of research that we want to do based on that. And so that is why it's been a successful collaboration with them. Yes. Yeah, we were asked to do it, but that's a 20-year history. So, with us and the university, we've published about 45 papers jointly, and they have been well received. And so it's essentially based on a history of collaboration.
Yeah. Well, a question at the back. Can you stand up, please, so I can hear you?
Oh, I'm so glad you asked.
Yep.
Buckle up, everybody. So, the environment was orange. Beautiful, 8 different shades of beautiful orange. It was going to look so good. And then I had a meeting with the professor of animal computer interaction, who owns cats and knows a lot about cats. And she said, I don't think the cats will like this orange. It's much too intense. And I said, but isn't it right that cats can't see the color red? And she said, well, yes, that is true, but I don't like this orange. I really don't think it's good. And I think it should be a natural color because cats like nature. And I was like, what about this environment makes you think of nature? I mean, it's not a natural environment. And essentially, it was one of those things where I had to back down in the face of her knowledge, just despite the fact that in my view there was no possible way that the cats were going to find the orange too much, and that it was entirely her judgment. But when you work with experts and researchers, sometimes their biases come into it, and so I just gave ground and was like, okay, we'll make it green.
So if you were 20 years old, you would choose orange?
Yeah.
Another question.
I would love to answer that with a slide. Yes. Yeah. Thanks for the question. It's a very good question. So the format of the work is that the cats were in the environment 6 hours a day for 12 days, and we with a time delay streamed the work to the World Science Fair in Brisbane in Australia, and made short highlight films every day to report on what was happening. And we've now made a video installation of this work, which is on show in London at the moment at the Science Gallery London. This is the happiness scores for Clover, Ghostbuster and Pumpkin over the 12 days. Clover, quite happy. Pumpkin, not so happy. It generally reflects the fact that Pumpkin slept a lot, and so he scored quite badly for his endless snoozing.
How does the score been made?
So, in reality, the computer vision system was not capable to do it, and so I was using a score of cat behavior that had been developed, and I am basically scoring every activity manually, and then that is being added into the system by the robot arm operator, and then the AI is learning from that.
Thanks.
Yeah, so we made these short highlight films, and I thought I would just show a minute of day one. So this is made in just a few hours, like we're really working overtime just to get this thing made and online. But we wanted to do some sort of report each day.
There's a lot of technology behind. Did you gain that research, or did you collaborate or ask people to help you out with this idea?
It's all made by researchers and developers at the University of Nottingham, roboticists and computer vision specialists. So I promise I am coming to your question. We wanted to try and make AI visible. One of the things that I really wanted was to see an AI in process, to see what it looks like day by day as an AI learns. But we also wanted to try and make the process open as well. So we actually asked people whether they would be willing to film their own cats and send us the footage to help us train the computer vision system. And seven members of the public said they would do that, and we sent them camera kits, and they then filmed their cats at home for a few hours. We cut that video into 5,000 clips, and we then uploaded it to a public science platform called Zooniverse, which is open to anyone, so that anyone could help us tag these 5,000 clips and see what it looks like when a human trains a computer vision system. And this is a little bit of footage of a user using the Zooniverse platform. It goes pretty fast on the right-hand side, so I might let it go through two times. So that says, can you see a cat in this clip? The person clicks yes, just one. What action is most prominent? Feeding. Eating, drinking, or not sure? Eating. How long is the action visible? Throughout the clip. Lastly, how would you rate their happiness in the clip? Somewhat happy. So, you know, what this shows is how arbitrary the whole thing is, right? Because who is to say how happy that cat is? But the human who is training the AI is asked to make that decision, so they make their best guess. And it's like, I would say that somewhat happy is probably about right, because a cat is eating and they are probably quite happy to be eating, but they're not very happy because they're only eating, you know? So it's like, the question is that a valid way to train a computer vision system or not? One other aspect of public involvement that we did was we created an audience advisory panel of 15 people who are representative of our audience, and we asked them to engage with us 6 times during the course of the work to give us their feedback and their input, and then we invited them all to come and see the work when it was installed in our studio. And that is again about making sure that we're kind of going out to a cross section of the public to talk to them about the work that we make.
Were there any problems that people will say, could you trust AI with your pet?
Do you mean were the concerns from the audience advisory panel? Yeah, of course. Yeah. And I think, as with so many of the works that we make, Kidnap is another good example. Beforehand, people can only see risk and danger and terrible outcomes. And so the idea that a robot next to a cat is a bad idea, for many people that became quite a fixation. You know, people were very, very concerned that this was a dangerous thing to do. And so, yeah, there were a lot of concerns.
Question.
Yeah, yes. In reality, the AI was not, the AI was picking from about 60 or 70 pre-programmed games, so the actual movement of the arm is not being affected by the AI, it's only which games it chooses. One of the other things that we did around safety was we had a dead man switch, which means that the robot arm operator had to be pressing a key down for anything to happen, and if for any reason they took their finger off that key, the whole thing would immediately stop. And so that was a kind of key sort of safety feature that we put in to make sure that there's no way anything could happen while someone wasn't paying attention. It did not understand overfeeding, and so it did start to overfeed, and so either Nick or I, we took it in turns, my fellow artist Nick and I, to be the lead on the project, we had to reject the AI at a certain point because, it was not good for the welfare of the cats. That's totally fixable, of course. If you have unlimited, if you have enough developer resource, that's an endless, eminently solvable issue. The thing, the problem we had is an extremely basic AI. You know, this is pretty much symbolic of what an AI does, as opposed to being a full AI. You know, we're working in a very basic level.
Would you ever make a project where humans not interfere in the outcome? As an AI, between the radical performance in the future?
I don't know. I think it would just depend on the work, really. It's hard to say. Yeah.
What do we see behind you?
So yeah, I mean, this is probably getting too nerdy, but like this is one of the earliest sort of system diagrams that my fellow artist Nick produced, which is like, okay, what are we building here? So you can see that you've got a robot arm on the top right and a computer vision system top left. And in the middle, you've got a control system, which is essentially the AI, and then a message broker that enables those three parts to talk to one another. And then at the bottom, it's spitting some things out into the logging system, so we're capturing all the data for subsequent research. And on the right, we're producing a public interface. We're spitting things out, like the happiness scores that we're then showing to the public. For those of you who are real nerds, we use a convolutional neural network. And the neural network we used is called the long short-term memory network. Please don't ask me about it. The reason that we use that is the long short-term memory is to do with the fact that it's able to kind of keep a record back in time. And so it's able to look at something where you've got video unfolding over time, and it can actually understand not just what it's looking at this instant, but what happened recently, and then factor that in.
Are you going to continue working with AI in the future for your projects? Now, are you learn this after this project?
Maybe. I certainly would love to do more sophisticated programming of AI. I think we really, really were dipping our toes in the water. So yeah.
In the audience. Oh, sorry, Olaf.
Yeah, no. So that was the Zooniverse process. That is how we. Yeah, that's humans training the computer vision system using those 5,000 clips. Yeah.
Does anybody here works also with AI or wants to work with AI? Yeah. Two persons.
I mentioned that the genesis of this project is through research. Here's a kind of the list of the different research areas that we were working with. And one of the ways in which we did that was that we had a one-hour conference every day during the 12 days where all of these people sat down with us, where I would report back on the previous 24 hours of what had happened with the cats and what we'd observed. They would ask questions, they would make suggestions, and they would also be there as a kind of brains trust to help deal with challenges or problems that we had. And so that dialogue between us and these researchers was a really important part of the work.
Any more questions here? Yeah.
So no cats were crushed. So that's result one. I am getting to your question. I'm sorry, I don't mean to be totally facetious. The AI did learn which game each of the three cats, it was able to learn individually which cat liked what, and it was able to maximize that. And I'm going to show a clip from the last day's video. Yeah. So I guess there's an artistic answer to that and a scientific answer to that. The scientific answer is that Dr. Kate Devlin, who's a researcher at King's College London, is doing a longitudinal study at Science Gallery London of public attitudes as to people based on them watching a seven-hour film of Cat Royale in the gallery. So she's looking at how that impacts people's perception and sense of trust in AI. And then there's an artistic answer to that, which is, what I wanted to create was a situation where there's a kind of uncanny sense that this is both charming and cute and fun and successful and dystopian and worrying and creepy. And I think that is the question that I want people to kind of be sitting with, because I do believe that AI is going to be transformative and enormously positive. I do feel that we as a civic society, all of us in this room, we all have a right to kind of have a voice in what kind of AI we get, and it should not be determined by engineers in California. And so we need the tools for us all to even begin to grasp what does that even mean? You know, if any of us were asked, what do you want from an AI? It's like, that's a very difficult question. So I suppose, moments where I feel like the work is really successful in that sense.
From an ethical point of view and a political point of view, who should then be part of feeding the AI at your point?
I mean, I don't know whether I can answer that question. You know, I don't know whether it's kind of...
From a creative point of view, from your own perspective as a creative artist, do you missing something now in the AI that you deal with or see in your in the future? But it's disturbing for you.
Yeah, it's disturbing. I think the hype about AI sort of reaching an exponential takeover of human intelligence, to me that's completely overblown. I don't buy any of that. This idea that we're sort of approaching the singularity. I saw an ex-Google engineer doing a podcast where he's talking about AI already has an IQ of 2,000, and by Christmas it already has an IQ of 200, mm-hmm. and by Christmas it will be have an IQ of 2,000 and stuff. And that's a complete kind of misrepresentation of what especially large language models are capable of doing. So we don't need to freak ourselves out completely. But this is like all of these forms of technology, which is how in a world in which the mindset of the market is so dominant and individual consumer choice is so dominant, how do we collectively find a voice and find mechanisms for us as a society and as a culture to determine the tools that we are all living with every day? And we clearly fucked that up in terms of social media, and we fucked that up in terms of mobile phones, and to a large degree in terms of the internet. So can we think about the next 10 years or the next 20 years, and can we find new mechanisms for doing that?
The platform we are using, like YouTube, TikTok, social media, is also your way of communicating your films. Mm-hmm. You're distributing on that platform. Do you think in the future that the artists would have their own controllable and not fucked up moments in terms of expressing themselves in a better way? Is there an option where AI could help, or is there a way you think from technology we push aside, we go more tactile experience, we go more analog? I'm just brainstorming now. Sorry.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't.
Well, in your own work.
So.
Yeah.
I mean, I suppose what I would say for maybe for people who are younger than me, mm-hmm. I'm 55. Mm-hmm. I grew up in the moment where the internet really did seem like a utopian thing, and only the cool people were on the internet. And there was no commerce, and it felt like there was an opportunity to remake society where people from around the world would be united on a digital platform. I know it sounds crazy. But that moment where something that was a commons, owned by no one, became privatized spaces like Facebook and so on, that has been the arc of my technological education. And so... that sense of like how you maintain a commons, you know, in England we went through this in the 1600s and the 1700s, which is all the land, everyone grazed all their animals on all the land, and then slowly people decided that they would take ownership of some of that land, and that then made their wealth enormously increase, and bit by bit they took over all the land, until now the idea that land is private and that you own slices of it is so common that none of us can, you know, we find it hard to think outside that model. So in technological terms, there is still an opportunity to create new forms of the commons. I don't know how you do that, but I think that part of it is about having a discussion and articulating that we want that.
You said also in the beginning of the first slide, the impact from the art, you know, your, I don't say motto, but you described that one. Is that also driving your collective to have the storytelling radical way of skeptical and sometimes mirroring the society or the people you engage into your project?
Yeah. I mean, I think so, yeah. I think, as I said, it's about trying to find critical positions that are also interesting as artistic experiences. You know, it's like really important to me that Cat Royale is not didactic, that it is playful, that it is inviting. I want someone who's 14 or 15 years old to be able to stumble on that and have a really rich experience where they're like, what am I looking at? You know, what
I
is
think
this?
A lot of people here
I'm curious about this. What is this? Because I had those experiences as a teenager, and I think many of us not know existed, you know. And it's like I remember going to see the first ever piece of theatre at the Institute of Contemporary Art in London when I was 18 years old, and I was like, oh my god, it's not people pretending to be lords and ladies, you know. It's like a new form of theatre is possible. It completely changed my way of thinking about the world.
Do we still have some time for a round question or a small one? Okay, we're going to round up a little bit, but
great, I'm nearly done.
All right. Oh, one question.
Yes, please. Deep and rigorous attention to semantics is a vital part of artistic creation, right? You have to pay the closest possible attention, and that is not to do with a kind of layer of intellectual sophistication. It can be in the most simple things. So, you know, I can't think of necessarily a good word to answer your question, but for example, understanding what was meant by game and how a game might unfold was about a 15-year journey in my career, because understanding that games could be many, many, many different things, and that the sophistication of games design is astonishing. When you look at some simple games like tic-tac-toe or something like that, you know, when you look at the actual mechanics of that as a game design, why that is still an interesting game, it's incredible that such a tiny architecture, a tiny algorithm creates that level of emergent behavior. That's incredible. So discovering that we didn't need to make interactive art, we could make a game, and that then a 10-year-old could come and go, cool, a game, what are we playing? And they have a completely different entry point into the work. That really was a revelation in terms of the projects that we made.
Did technology change the word game for you in your existence time?
I guess I only ever came to games in the frame of technology. You know, it was through already starting to work with VR in the late 1990s, and then thinking about what does virtual mean, and that led me off onto a journey both into computer science and into Jean Baudrillard, and so then trying to think about, okay, virtuality, what even is this thing? Being able to land that back into, let's make a war game set in the Iraq War in 1991. Mm-hmm. That was the way in which I kind of found a way out of this kind of landscape that was so complex, I didn't know quite how to handle it.
Great show.
Yeah, so I just thought to finish, I'd show a couple of clips from the last film that we made on day 12. First of all, this is the beginning of the day 12 film.
Magic.
myself to just record a little bit of the voiceover myself, because I felt like Johnny, who's our comms person, whose voice you've heard, did an amazing job. I felt like, oh, we need something where we as artists have a voice in the world.
As the cat spent their last afternoon in the room, the whole team slowly gathered around the two-way mirrors to watch. I felt suddenly sad seeing Clover play with the robot for the last time. We've tried to measure her happiness, but maybe what Clover wants is not what she needs. Hopefully we've given her and Ghostbuster and Pumpkin a life-enriching experience, but we'll never know that. The cats in Cat Royale are, of course, us. We are experimenting with a culture that privileges choice and consumer power above all else. What does it mean when our every whim can be met by automated systems? When our desires can be met so quickly, the satisfaction that we seek becomes more fleeting and insubstantial as a result. And now that the most powerful companies on Earth can quickly roll out their products to billions of people with the goal of instant gratification, what costs might be paid for AI?
I'm very curious about one thing I must, when I see this, it's the last thing, affection, the word affection. Because we talk about food, we talk about games. How do you see the that specific part? What I'm missing in this game setting?
Yeah.
What I know from a cat. I mean, I'm not a cat person, but after when I sit in a room and I see a cat walking by and jumps on me, say, do I have to rub him and just spinning around and feel a certain affection or feeling? I think it's happiness when he spins around. So I'm curious in that sense for the observation.
Yeah, I mean, obviously. What does a cat actually want from a human is a kind of question that some of us wrestle with, right? Because it's like sometimes cats act as if that's the last thing that they need. We were very aware that there would be a potential animal rights challenge to this work, and we spent 6 months producing a hostile media plan because we assumed that there would be a campaign to shut this work down. And I did hostile media training as part of it. We did a whole set of preparations around the possible messaging that would, by which people would attack the work, and then how we would talk about that. In the event, the biggest criticism that was constant was, those cats need humans. You're depriving them because they don't have humans in there. Obviously, they were only in this room for 3 hours at a time, and so it's like any domestic cat is without a human for 3 hours at a time, right? That's the sort of standard thing. But the weirdest moments that I had in this work, as I watched through that two-way mirror for hour after hour after hour, is that there were moments where the robot is playing with the cat, and both the robot and the cat seem in perfect synchronicity together. And I suddenly had this moment of feeling like that cat is having more fun than it would with a human dangling a feather on a stick. Because it doesn't have to worry about the human. It knows that the human is a major factor. But in this moment, there is no human. It's just them and the feather. And okay, it's just a simulation of a prey. It's not a proper bird that it would love to be catching and playing with. Mm-hmm. But in that simulation, that cat is having a really rich experience. And it is as rich, you know, the robot will play endlessly without deviation, and the cat is like, yes, give me endless games without deviation. Yeah, so that was a really strange thing where the affection is between the robot and the cat. The cat is feeling some affection for the robot, and maybe we're not quite as central, us humans, as we like to think.
Any question around, last question. So the interaction between the three cats, you mean, being captured? All right.
So it was incredibly unsophisticated in terms of the group dynamics. We really did no, the AI and the computer vision system did no measuring of that. We weren't even able to map the proximity of one cat to another cat and use that as an input for the system. We wanted to, but it was just, we weren't able to reach that. In terms of the social dynamics, one of the things that was interesting is you would have heard a mention earlier on about a cat welfare officer, and the cat welfare officer was present through the glass on the other side of the two-way glass, and every 15 minutes she gave a score of the happiness of the cats, totally independent from the system. She has no idea of the system, she's just doing her own observation. The woman who did that was a scientific officer at the Royal Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, one of the biggest animal welfare charities in the UK, and an expert in her own right in feline behavior. And she observed that what the owner of the cats, who was there as well, attributed as play, he would say, oh, they're playing together, Clover's playing with Ghostbuster. Privately, she turned to me and she said, that is not play, they are fighting for dominance, right? What he is interpreting as playful fun is not actually playful fun. And that we as humans are often incredibly bad judges of what our animals like. And so even the thing of taking an animal like a dog or a cat and bringing its face up to our face and giving it a kiss, it's like most dogs and cats detest that activity, right? They suffer it because they know that we're humans, but that is not what they like. So, that sense of the sort of social dynamics is like, there are lots of things that are poorly understood, you know? There aren't many studies of cat happiness, for example. It's too fuzzy a term for most cat researchers.
All right. Give them big applause. Oh, can I give one question? For Sorry.
What happened with them? I mean, we don't need them anymore. I mean, it's... no, Ed's, who owns all three of those cats, was present throughout, and on day 12, he put them back in their carrying cases and he took them back home. And they.
Why cats? Why not dogs? Sorry, but last question.
Sorry, did you want to follow up? Okay.
No, you cannot do it now. Come on, we hear all.
I mean, Ghostbuster and Clover learnt to what time of day they would be going into the environment, and they would come and queue at the door waiting to be let in. So they were excited. Pumpkin wasn't so bothered, but Clover and Ghostbuster really were. So in that sense, they learnt that something was interesting was going to happen in that space. I wouldn't say anything else in terms of their behavior, not that I observed. I mean, it may be that the cat welfare officer could tell you something of that, but I didn't. Yeah.
You have a more question. Oh, so not.
Yeah.
Technology is related to theater, correct?
Yeah.
All right.
I find it hard to find theater that I really connect with, but I do think that the rise of immersive theater in the last 15 years has created a new kind of primacy of live performance, and there's something about live performance that most of us still find incredibly compelling, and obviously live music is, you know, as popular as it's ever been. You know, I have to commiserate with friends who are parents trying to get tickets to Taylor Swift. You know, in the UK, it's like, you know, unlimited amounts of money. Those tickets could go for £1,000, £2,000, and they would all sell out. So there's something about live performance that is primal and connecting, and there's a kind of anti-technology thing that. Is also present, you know, as things are more and more digital, the significance of a vinyl record kind of grows. So I think theatre has a real role, and I think technology really has the potential to change theatre for the better. And I would love to do more work in that area. You know, setting, I think there's much more that can be done there.
All right. Before I put you guys to test, give them a welcome applause to Matt and thank him. Thanks for coming. Come ahead, on the guys. I will give you the mic.
Thank you very much. I'm do closing off with just a couple of announcements. Joey, if you can get back to press spacebar on my laptop and get back to that sign. I just have a couple of I think spacebar. No, it's the one. Is the one? There's one other image in there. Awesome. Yes, thank you. You're the best. So I have a couple of announcements. First one is called Werklab. This artist talk is one half of the things that we in this 2 years are doing. The other one is called Werklab, where we take other artists, younger artists, emerging artists, and help them out in some way with questions, either practical or technical or conceptual. If you're interested in that, come find me, send us a message the coming year and a half. We're still accepting people and helping them out. The second part is this next artist talk. So number three is with Pablo Valbuena. It's on December the 1st, here again. Put it in your calendar already if you really enjoy this one and the last one. He's a very interesting light artist, video artist. He's very cool. It's just an amazing dude. Yeah, I don't know what to say about it. He's just really cool. And then the last thing is for Club Forward, which is a group of community of people who are very interested in digital culture from Groningen, who get together once a month every last Monday of the month at Grand Theater. And if you're interested in that, come by. We have a talk with a lot of people, mostly also from more local community. You get to share more. The next one is on October the 30th. Yeah. Come by. It's in Grand Theater in the center. Thank you very much. And I have some couple of other announcements. So we have some drinks here now. It lasts until 11, and then we're all kindly asked to leave. Thank you very much.